24, have you been washed? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? 224, you've been singing well, so let's keep up the good singing. You'll be better when you're standing. 224. Close our eyes and bow our heads as we come into the presence of the Lord and ask his help to take away all the distractions of today and tomorrow as we focus on him and on his word and what he has to say to us. Our Heavenly Father, we once again come before thee, and we're thankful that we can come through the rent veil into the presence of the holiest of all. And how holy is our God, pure and undefiled from the very beginning, one who has no beginning and no end, and one who provided for us his dear Son, our Saviour, who bore our sin upon the tree. And we're thankful tonight that we have such a Saviour, the one who shed his precious blood, the one who died upon the cross, the one who bore the agonies of physical pain, but also the pain of separation from a holy God as he took upon himself the sins of his people. And we are grateful tonight as thy people for your mercy to us. We thank thee tonight that in so bringing us unto yourself, from the very beginning, you thought upon us. As you bore our sin upon the tree, you thought upon us. You thought our name, you thought our circumstances, you knew all about us long before we ever were to set foot upon the face of the earth. And as we contemplate such mercy, how unfathomable it is. How unfathomable it is to know that a God who knew us and provided for us a Saviour before we even existed. And we ask and we pray tonight that you would accept of our thanks for your mercy to us, And we pray that in this meeting our hearts would be overjoyed with the mercy and grace that is ours. And we pray tonight that as we gather around your word, as we have had the liberty to be here and come here and to sit here, we are asking that you indeed would make us a joyful people. We do pray tonight for those that are gathered in, perhaps, and they don't have that joy in their heart. They don't have that assurance. And we pray tonight that your Spirit would, in mercy, as it did for us, come before them and show them their sin and bring them unto thyself. We have a God who does not have anything else to ask of us except to simply come and to ask for forgiveness for our sins and to throw him ourselves upon his mercy. We pray again for the houses around about, those that are within earshot of this gospel service. We pray for them. We ask that you would speak. We pray that you would draw them unto yourself. And we pray that even as the word of God goes forth now over the loudspeakers or over the internet later on, we pray that a heart would be convicted of their sin and brought unto thyself. We do ask and we do pray that you would bless the fellowship here. We're thankful for it. We're thankful for the people of God who meet here faithfully week in and week out as a testimony to the word of God that is preached faithfully in this church. We pray that you would bless them. We pray that you would bless their families. We know that all of us have those in our family circle that are still outside of Christ, and we pray that you indeed would help us to bring them before them. Bless every endeavor in the gospel in the week that lies before us. We pray that as the church doors are open on the various nights and occasions where there is the gathering together of a meeting, we pray that your Spirit would be here. You've promised to be here, and we ask and pray that that Spirit, that he would do his mighty work in the conviction of souls. We do pray now that you would bless us, bless in the reading of your word, bless in the singing of these lovely hymns, but most of all, bless in the ministry and preaching of your word, that indeed the word of God would be opened up, and that indeed the word of God would come forth again with freshness and with beauty, as indeed it is on each and every occasion. So continue with us now, we pray. Bless us and undertake for us. In Christ's name we ask it. Amen. 311, please. Blessed assurance, Jesus is mine. Oh, what a foretaste of glory divine. 311.
Filled with his goodness.
If we could turn to Psalm 105, please. And we're going to read the first 12 verses of this psalm together. Psalm 105, first 12 verses, please. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the people. Sing unto him, sing psalms unto him, talk ye of all his wondrous works. Glory ye in his holy name, let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Seek the Lord and his strength, seek his face evermore. Remember his marvelous works that he hath done, his wonders, and the judgments of his mouth. O ye seed of Abraham, his servant, ye children of Jacob, his chosen, he is the Lord our God, his judgments are in all the earth. He hath remembered his covenant forever, the word which he commanded to a thousand generations, which covenant he made with Abraham and his oath unto Isaac, and confirmed the same unto Jacob for a law, and to Israel for an everlasting covenant, saying, Unto thee will I give the land of Canaan, the lot of your inheritance. When they were but a few men in number, yea, very few, and strangers in it. And we know the Lord will bless the reading of his word. We'd like to welcome everyone along again to the gospel service. And if you're visiting with us or if you're listening later on, you're very welcome to our meeting here together. And we trust and pray that your gathering together with us will be a blessing to you. If we could ask the ladies to just briefly wait behind after the service tonight just to arrange some details for the barbecue. And if you haven't put your name on the sheet there as you go out for the barbecue on Saturday, please do so. It'll be your last opportunity. Some reminders of the week's meetings. First of all, Monday night is the committee meeting at 8 p.m. So, brethren, if you can remember that, please. Tuesday night is the gospel bus meeting with the boys and girls. And again, we can all and you can all pray for that work as we meet with the boys and girls. Wednesday night is the Bible study and prayer meeting at 8 p.m. And in the will of the Lord, the Reverend Henderson will be ministering to us. And then Friday night is the late night men's prayer meeting between 10 and 11 p.m. And again, if you are available and you want to be in the place of prayer, as you should be, you come and join with us. Saturday is the Sabbath school outing, meeting at the church here at 10:15. And then for everyone at 5:30, the church barbecue. And as I've said already, the list is there. Sign up, put your name on it if you haven't already done so. Next Lord's Day, there will be no Bible class on Sunday school for the month of July and August. Both will resume again on the third Sunday, the 17th of September. Morning worship is at 12 noon, preceded by the time of prayer at 11:30, as usual. And, of course, the evening service at 7 p.m., preceded by the time of prayer at 6:30. Today is the maintenance fund offering. And again, can we thank God's people for their tremendous giving for the work in Pakistan at the prayer meeting recently of £536. Your efforts in this regard are much appreciated. Just a few forthcoming meetings to remind you of and for you to pray for. First of all, the five-day club for the boys and girls in Drumlin Grange will take place between the Monday the 3rd to Friday the 7th of July at 2 p.m. each day, Monday through to Friday. And again, if you can help out, if you can be there, that would be very much appreciated. And of course, continue to pray for the planned gospel mission between the 10th and 24th of September in the church hall. You can be praying for that, and you can be praying for the Lord's guidance on those that you should ask to come. Do continue to pray for the sick, for those that are unable to get out regularly to the house of God, and of course, the bereaved. And of course, all of these things are subject to the mind and will of God. For our offering hymn, can you turn please now to 248, another great hymn. These are great hymns, great words. You've been singing really well. So 248, And we'll sing the first three verses sitting as the tithes and offerings are received, and then for the last two verses we'll stand. 248, please, singing your very best.
For the floods on the thirsty land, oh, for a mighty revival, oh, for a sanctified, fearless band ready to hail its arrival. I trust that'll be our hearts today. Once again, let me thank Mr. Bell for leading the service. We do appreciate that help indeed. But we're turning in the Word of God together, please, to that psalm that was read earlier, Psalm 105. Psalm 105, and we're looking at the verse 3, and really the last part of the verse 3, it says, "Glory ye in his holy name." And then these words form our text, verse 3, "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. We're looking at the title or the subject tonight, the joy of seeking Christ. The joy of seeking Christ. Let's bow in a word of prayer together, please. Let's ask for the Lord's help. Let's still our hearts before him now and pray that the Lord would speak and speak mightily to our hearts, and that this time would be a blessing to us. Heavenly Father, we thank thee that there is joy unspeakable in the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank thee that there is life, eternal life, abundant life. And we do pray, if there be one in our midst that doesn't yet have the promise or the guarantee of eternal life, that they will come to Christ even now. Lord, we realize many in this gathering are children of the King, but At the same time, we're conscious that there are some that may not be. And they know their own hearts, Lord. They can be honest with themselves as to whether they're saved or not. But we ask that before this meeting is out, that they would have made that decision to follow hard after thee, that they would have repented and believed the gospel, and that we would rejoice with them and with the whole of heaven over one sinner that repenteth. So, Lord, go before us. Give us help. Give us strength. We plead and pray. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. We live in a world that is largely filled with sorrow. And I don't think anyone would argue the point with me about that. This world has many sorrows, and you ask, why? And often that is the question that is asked, isn't it? Why is that the case? Why do bad things happen? Why is there tears? Why is there sorrow? Well, we find the answer is actually in our text. We read the verse 3 together. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. And you say, quite rightly, but it doesn't mention sorrow. It doesn't mention anything about it in our verse. No, not necessarily, but read it the opposite way around. Then you'll find the answer. The heart of them mourn that reject the Lord. That's the exact opposite to our verse. It says, let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Well, the opposite is, let the heart of them mourn that reject the Lord. And that is the key. That is why this world is full of sorrow, sin. Just a little word, three letters, S-I-N, yet sin is the huge problem that all of us have to contend with. Sin is the cause of all of our sorrow and sadness. Sin is the reason why hospitals are full and waiting lists are endless. Sin is the reason why undertakers are busy and death columns are full. Sin is the reason why sickness and age and tears afflict us. Sin is the reason. Sin is the whole summary of it all. But isn't it wonderful that in this text, our God promises rejoicing in Christ. And there is happiness, there is joy everlasting in the Lord Jesus Christ. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. You see, this world doesn't know real joy. Though you could go into, I don't know, say Banbridge town centre on a Friday and a Saturday night, you could stand outside many of the pubs and clubs and places of this world, and people will be trying their utmost to fulfill their cravings with an artificial joy and an artificial rejoicing. But this world doesn't know anything of true, everlasting, and abundant joy that is only found in Christ. Come with me to Psalm 144, please. Psalm 144, and look at the verse 15, because we find that we are promised great rejoicing in Christ and rejoicing in this life. We don't just have to wait till heaven to rejoice. You know, people talk about heaven, and heaven is a wonderful theme to talk about, and you think about the glory, and you think about the very idea of seeing the Lord face to face. But our rejoicing and our joy is not reserved until our death day or the day of the Lord's return. We can be a happy people right now. We read Psalm 144, verse 15. Happy is that people that is in such a case. Yea, happy is that people whose God is the Lord. I ask, do you have that happiness, that happiness which only God can give? And of course, yes, there's happiness in life, and then there's happiness in death. 2 Corinthians 5 and the verse 8 says, we are confident, I say, and willing rather to be absent from the body and to be present with the Lord. And that is joy unspeakable right there, to see the Lord face to face, to walk around the streets of gold, to hear the angelic chorus and choir, to see our mansion in the skies, to be reunited with loved ones that are gone before. What a joy it is to be present with the Lord. And Revelation 21 and the verse 4 tells us a little more of those days. And God shall wipe away all tears from their eyes. And there shall be no more death, neither sorrow nor crying, neither shall there be any more pain, for the former things are passed away. And where does all of this lie? What is the key to all of this? Well, Psalm 105 and the verse 3 really, in a sense, hits the nail on the head. Where does sin or sorrow come from? Comes from sin. Where does our joy be found? It be found in Christ. And Psalm 105 verse 3 says, "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." Psalm 105 is a psalm of praise, describing all of God's benefits to his people, namely the children of Israel in this particular instance. You see that in the verses 1 and 2. Look what it says, "O give thanks unto the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the people." The idea is spreading. The Lord has done something for me, and I'm going to tell it. You know, at times the Lord blesses us, doesn't he? And we keep it all to ourselves. How selfish that is. The Lord has blessed you today. Share it with someone. Look what it says in the verse 1. "Make known his deeds among the people." Verse 2. "Sing unto him, sing psalms unto him. Talk ye of all his wondrous works." And this is a psalm of praise. Verse 8. If you look there with me, please. Another wonderful truth. "He hath remembered his covenant." That is a tremendous phrase in and of itself, but the sentence doesn't finish there. "He hath remembered his covenant forever." Two wonderful words, well worth highlighting or marking in your Bible, that our God never breaks his word and never breaks a promise. And as we finished our reading there, it was a covenant, a promise to Israel that they would be given the promised land, a land that they are still in today. Quite tremendous. The Lord has kept his covenant forever. And really, the summary of the psalm can be found in verses 43 to the end. It says, "And he brought forth his people with joy, and his chosen with gladness, and gave them the lands of the heathen, and they inherited the labor of the people, that they might observe his statutes and keep his laws. Praise ye the Lord." So we find this is a psalm of praise, and the verse 3 sums it all up. "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." But I ask very simply, very plainly, the outset of our introduction today, are you part of that happy people? Are you rejoicing night and day as you walk the narrow way? Do you know what it is to be saved? Do you know what it is to have joy unspeakable in your heart? Do you know what it is to know that actually the sadness at times does come across the believer? It is only a temporary sadness, because generally speaking, we are given a great happiness and joy that only God can give. Are you happy because you've sought the Lord? That's the question tonight. Are you happy because you've sought the Lord? As we look at the verse 3, I want you to note three things with me. Number one, the heart. Number two, the seeking. And number three, the rejoicing. So number one, the heart. It says in our verse, "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." Now, the heart is a very interesting subject, and I'm sure each and every one of us here know what it's talking about, but a lot of people think of the heart as an organ, which it is an organ. It's that fatty muscle in our chest that pumps our blood around our bodies, keeps us breathing, keeps us alive. In fact, apparently the human heart beats 100,000 times per day. Isn't that amazing? 100,000 reasons to thank the Lord for his goodness toward you today. It pumps approximately 1.5 gallons of blood around your body every minute. Tremendous, isn't it? Another reason to thank the Lord. And apparently, just as another fact, the most number of heart attacks actually occur on Christmas Day. It's sort of a strange fact. I don't know if it's anything to do with the cost of all the presents or the eating of all the food or having to sit all day with your mother-in-law. I don't know what the reason is, but apparently that's the worst day to have a heart attack, Christmas Day. But of course, all of you know, I would think, that the verse 3 isn't talking about that fatty muscle within our chest. It's not talking about that. It's talking about something far greater, far deeper, something that we do understand. It's talking about our desires, our emotions, what a whole drive is. And we know this because any of you that are married or anything like that, you say things, these lovely gushy sentiments, don't you? I love you. And what do you say? I love you with all of my heart. And you say things like that. Why? Because you know exactly what the verse 3 is talking about. It's something more than just an organ or a muscle. It's talking about desires, emotions, things like that. And you see, this is the issue. This is the problem. The heart of the problem is the heart. And it says, let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. And I just want to tell you, really, at the start of this message, the problem is that our hearts are naturally corrupted. Our hearts are naturally sinful because of what Adam and Eve did in the Garden of Eden all those years ago at the beginning of time. You and I sinned in Adam's sin, that plague of sin cut across everybody's heart, all of us that are born by ordinary generation from the seed of Adam, and we find all of us have a corrupt heart. Come with me to Jeremiah 17. Jeremiah 17 and the verses 9 and 10 talks about the problem that our hearts have, the issue of the heart, and it's serious. I cannot overestimate or underestimate, rather, the significance of this, because Jeremiah 17 and the verse 9 highlights our problem. And maybe you're here and you think you're a good person, you think you're okay, and you think you'll just be all right when it comes to death and standing before God. Not so, friend, if you're without Christ. Because Jeremiah 17 verse 9 says, the heart is deceitful above all things. When you consider that, if you were to weigh up all things that are deceitful, Jeremiah, and namely the Spirit of God, says the heart is the most deceitful. The heart is the most deceitful. The heart is deceitful above all things. And desperately wicked, who can know it? You know, a lot of people finish at the verse 9, and they say, our sin, it's terrible. Our hearts are deceitful, they're wicked. Who can know it? But the question has an answer in the verse 10. I, the Lord, search the heart. That's very serious. I can't stress to you enough how serious that actually is. Because not only is our heart full of sin, not only is our heart full of rebellion, not only is our heart deserving of the wages of sin, which is death, but we find that the judge, the supreme judge, the sovereign judge, the one that we will stand in judgment before at that great and final day, the Lord himself can search the heart and try the reins. Now, you stand in any court of law, tried whether falsely or justly for a crime in this country, you'll stand before a judge. And that judge does not know whether you are innocent or guilty. You have to have lawyers and witnesses and all the rest of it come and make the case. And then some has to come in and decide, yes, I think they're either innocent or guilty with the evidence before me. I want to tell you this. The judge of all the earth, he saw it all. He knows it all. And he knows your heart and mine. I, the Lord, search the heart. That's very serious. Come with me to Romans 3, especially when we consider our problem. Because Romans 3 tells us that actually we're not as good as we think we are. Actually, we're not as moral as we like to think we are. Times we're not as just and upright and caring and thoughtful as we would like to think we are. And actually, Romans 3 exposes us exactly for who and what we are. Romans 3 verse 10 says, there is none righteous, no, not one. There is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh after God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good, no, not one. This is serious. This is serious, serious problems that we are facing, the issue of our sin. Verse 23 says of that same chapter, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And verse 19 tells us of that judgment day, of that day in our sin with our rebellious hearts that we have to stand before God. It says, now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law, that every mouth may be stopped and all the world may become guilty before God. You think you're doing well? You're not doing well. Friend, if you don't have Christ, you don't have anything of value. If you're in your sin, you're guilty. Guilty is charged. You're facing hell. You're facing wrath. And you know, friend, not to be light over this, but you deserve it as well. I deserve it. We all deserve the wrath of God. Come with me to Psalm 51 and the verse 10. Psalm 51 and the verse 10, that's why we need to cry something before the Lord. This is the issue of the heart. This is the problem of our souls. But that's why we need to cry a prayer unto the Lord. And I do plead with you, if you're here and you're not yet saved, I urge you, make this prayer your prayer tonight. Psalm 51 and the verse 10, the psalmist cries out, "Create in me a clean heart, O God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me." But the idea, create in me a clean heart, that's what we need. And you don't need to turn to it, I'll turn to it for you. Ezekiel 36 and the verse 26 tells us further to that, "A new heart also will I give you." So we find if you pray that prayer, if you ask for that new heart, the Lord has promised, "A new heart also will I give you, and a new spirit will I put within you. And I will take away the stony heart out of your flesh, and will give you an heart of flesh." So as we look at Psalm 105 and the verse 3, "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." There's an awful lot the Scripture has to say about the heart. And it's not good. Not good, because it exposes our sin. But I want you to notice not only the heart, but secondly, the seeking. The seeking. Look what we find in our verse, Psalm 105, verse 3. "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." That seek the Lord. Now, in order to obtain this rejoicing, this joy, this happiness that only the people of God can have, you need a new heart. And in order to obtain a new heart, then seeking is vital. That's what we're reading in the verse. "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." So seeking is vital. Now, the key to all of this is not just seeking, but who we're seeking. Because there's a lot of people out there seeking. Oh, the vast majority of people in this world follow some form of religion or another. Atheism isn't the largest belief system. I say belief system because it takes more belief to believe in atheism than it does in religion. But anyway, there's far more belief in a deity than there is atheists in this world. Oh, you have Muslims and Hindus and Sikhs and Roman Catholics, and you have all sorts of cults and anything else under the sun. You have the atheist that believes in the God of themselves through the process of being a monkey and transforming themselves into a man and all the rest of it. There's an abundance of belief systems in this world. It's not just about seeking. Plenty of people seeking in this world. You go to the local chapel, you'll find people going in every Sunday, every Saturday night. They're seeking for something, but they're looking in the wrong place. You find right across the nation of the United Kingdom, go to any doors of a mosque, you'll see hundreds of people pouring in, and they'll be seeking, but they're seeking in the wrong place. What does it say in the verse 3? That seek the Lord. That's the key. That seek the Lord, let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. So friend, if you're seeking just for a God or seeking for a book or seeking for a good and a moral life or seeking for a church or seeking good works in charity or seeking anything else, that will not prosper you. You need to seek the Lord. The point is that Christ can be found tonight. You need to seek Him and to seek Him alone. He is the only one that can redeem you. He is the only one worth seeking. He is the only one that can liberate you. Come with me to Revelation 21, please, because something I want to highlight to you is this. As I've already tried to say when looking at the heart, our sin deserves hell. It deserves hell, deserves eternal torment, deserves the wrath of God, deserves hell and the lake of fire after that again. In Revelation 21 and the verse 8, really exposes that to us. It says, but the fearful and unbelieving. Well, that's everyone that doesn't seek the Lord, the unbelieving. And look what else it says. And the abominable, and murderers, and whoremongers, and sorcerers, and idolaters, and all liars. Now, you can look and look and look, but you'll find if you're outside of Christ, one of those descriptions at least will fit you. You will fit into that list. All of us do. And look what it says, shall have their part in the lake which burneth with fire and brimstone, which is the second death. That's what we deserve. That's what our sin merits. That is what we ought to have, eternal misery forevermore. But the wonderful truth is that we can seek tonight. Now, let me say something else, that naturally, because of our hearts having the problem that they have with their sin and their disease of sin, we're not naturally even inclined to seek the Lord. Romans 3 tells us that there is none that understandeth, there is none that seek after the Lord. So what do we find about seeking? If you're here tonight and you're actually pursuing the Lord and wondering, how can I get saved? How can I be right with God? How can I be redeemed? I would dare say the Lord has already been working in your soul, and a work of redemption is going to be accomplished, because naturally, in and of ourselves, we have no desire whatsoever to get saved. We have no desire to get right with God. And you see, friend, this seeking in and of itself is a mercy from the Lord, that he allows us to do it in the first place through the opening of our eyes by the Holy Spirit. But the point is, we can seek the Lord. We can seek Christ. There is a Savior on offer. We are not seeking the Lord in some vain hope of having our sin debt paid for. We're not seeking the Lord in some idea that he's still angry and still wroth with us and still won't be merciful to us, and it's a false hope that we possess, because that's what Rome would teach you. Why does the Roman Catholic pray to the Virgin Mary? Why do they do that? Because Rome pictures Christ as this angry, vengeful Savior that has no time for you. And the idea of Rome is, talk to his mother, and his mother will talk to him to try and nearly calm him down so that maybe you'll get some mercy from him. That's not the Christ of the Bible. The Word of God tells us that Christ is willing to save, Christ is willing to save to the uttermost, and Christ is able to do so out of love. Romans 5 verse 8, one of my favorite verses, which you hear probably every week, but God commendeth his love toward us, in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Praise God, we can seek the Savior because the Savior has come, because the Savior lived the perfect life that we could never live, because the Savior died that atoning death upon the tree. It was because of all that he did upon that cross. When you think of the scourging that he endured, when you think of the mocking that he endured, when you think of the spittle that ran down his face, when you think of how they beat him and essentially tortured him, when you think of how then they put a cross on his back, made him drag it till he could carry it no longer, when you consider how they nailed him through his hands and through his feet, when you think how they caused him to hang there and bleed and die, but not only the physical agonies, you consider how he was willing to bear our sin upon his own body on the tree and bear the cup of God's wrath, our hell for us, upon that tree. Friend, the good news is this, that if you're seeking and seeking the Lord, praise God, the Lord is available to be sought. There is actually a Savior. There is actually one that can redeem you from a lost sinner's hell. That's why it says Christ died for the ungodly. He didn't die for the godly. They that be whole need not a physician. Christ died for the ungodly. That's you and me. And that's why he came. That's the good news. Come with me to Jeremiah 29, please. Jeremiah 29 and the verse 13. A wonderful verse that I want to leave with you. And the idea that, yes, there is a Savior. There is really the Lord there that can be sought and is willing to be found. And Jeremiah 29 and the verse 13 goes that step further, and we find the Lord tells us now that there is hope for those that seek. And it says, Jeremiah 29 verse 13, "And ye shall seek me and find me." I don't know about you, but I find that wonderful. If you're in the habit of marking your Bibles, they're three words well worth highlighting. If ye shall seek me and find me, you shall find me when ye shall search for me. Now note the language again, likened unto the psalmist that we're looking at, with all your heart, with all your heart. You see, the Lord won't tolerate half-heartedness. The Lord won't tolerate you giving half of your life or 80% of your life and keeping a little bit for sin and a skeleton in your closet. The Lord won't tolerate that. That's Christendom today, by the way. People come to church, people even say they're Christians, and they live like the world every other day of the week and pretend to be godly on a Sunday. The Lord doesn't tolerate that. The Lord expects you to seek Him with all the heart. And only then will you find Him. Only then will you find Him. But then we find the heart and we find the seeking. But then thirdly and lastly, the rejoicing. The rejoicing. And I want to encourage God's people tonight. It says, "Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord." It's a wonderful word, rejoice, isn't it? As I started off, we live in a world that is largely filled with sorrow. But the heart of the believer ought not to be filled with sorrow. The Church of Jesus Christ ought not to be filled with sorrow. We ought to be a happy people, a rejoicing people, knowing, yes, my heart, deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, knowing my heart deserved hell because of its sin, yet Christ has redeemed me. Christ has given me a new heart to seek Him with all that heart and to find Him. And yes, now I can say I'm rejoicing, rejoicing night and day. There is no greater happiness than knowing that Christ died for you, friend. There's no greater happiness in knowing not only Christ died, but that Christ has actually, in reality and in its totality, washed my sins away. There is no greater rejoicing given than thinking that now, even though I deserved eternity of hell, actually I have been handed eternal life in heaven, in home, forevermore. What rejoicing ought to possess the Christian tonight? What rejoicing ought to control our hearts and minds? And our text is true, by the way. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Let us just go on a little excursion around our Bibles as we finish off. Look at Philippians 4 and the verse 4, please. Philippians 4 and the verse 4. I want to highlight to you that it's not just Psalm 105 that talks about you being happy as a believer. But Philippians 4 and the verse 4 talks about being happy as a believer. In fact, we can nearly hear the tone in the Apostle Paul's voice. Because, you know, as we read the Word of God, we need to remember that Paul was not just a writer. He was a preacher. And you can nearly hear the preacher's voice coming through. In Philippians 4 and the verse 4, you can hear the excitement, the enthusiasm, the passion. Nothing worse than hearing a dead sermon to dead people and a dead congregation flourishes nothing from it. Oh, we have passion from Paul here. It says in Philippians 4, verse 4, "Rejoice in the Lord always." He doesn't finish there, does he? You hear the preacher's voice, you hear the passion. And again I say, rejoice! You can hear it in him, can't you? The idea that he's bubbling over with joy and happiness and blessedness. This is what God has done. Rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say, rejoice. Truly remarkable. There's joy for those that seek the Lord with the whole heart. Come with me to Psalm 5 and the verse 11. Psalm 5 and the verse 11. And I show you these things because this world will try and paint Christianity as being a sad, dull religion. I tell you this, that's not my religion. That's not what I believe in. If your Christianity is sad and miserable and painful and you're enduring it, and friend, you're not saved yet. You're not a Christian. Because a child of God is to be happy and not enduring Christ, but enjoying Christ. And Psalm 5 and the verse 11 tells us, look at it, but let all those that put their trust in thee, look at it, rejoice. And look at this, it goes further, let them ever shout for joy, because thou defendest them. Let them also that love thy name be joyful in thee. Oh, it's so emphatic, isn't it? And then one more, 1 Thessalonians 5 and the verse 16. And here we find, as Paul finishes off this first letter, he writes a number of short verses in that sense. He writes some very short verses, and we find a two-word sentence, and a two-word sentence that is well worth remembering, well worth highlighting, underlining, marking in your Bible. He just simply says, 1 Thessalonians 5 and the verse 16, very simple truth, rejoice evermore. Rejoice evermore. Doesn't just say rejoice, because at times we don't feel like rejoicing. It says rejoice evermore. Every day, thank the Lord for his goodness toward you. Because my salvation is not one of enduring Christ. It ought to be enjoying him, rejoicing in him, happy in him. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. And as I often say, I'll say it again, I've never met a Christian that has regretted finding Christ. I've never met one saying, I wish I didn't get saved because there's so much I can't do now that I'm saved. I've never met anyone like that. No. Why? Because there's joy in the Savior. I don't know who's listening tonight in that sense. Your heart, maybe you're a Christian and you're downcast. I tell you, friend, rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice in the Lord. I know it's not easy, but consider all that he has done for you and rejoice. But I tell you, sinner friend, will you not learn how to rejoice? Not in some trinket that this world will produce for you. Not some temporary joy that will fizzle out at the end of the evening. Not some joy that is only a temporary measure, but real rejoicing, real joy, lasting happiness that only Christ can give. That is the joy of seeking Christ. You know, friends, I'll just finish by quoting to you from Psalm 51. Because in Psalm 51 and the verse 12, it says these words. If you're one of those that is struggling with joy, maybe you are saved, maybe you know you haven't been truly walking with the Lord either. And you know, actually, I'm in a backslidden condition, and your joy has vanished in the immediate. But the verse 12 of Psalm 51 says, restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy free spirit. Maybe you need to come with that same petition, Lord, forgive me of my sin afresh tonight. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation. Give me that joy, give me that happiness that alone is found when walking with God. But I encourage all, whether you be in your sin tonight, not yet saved, whether you be backslidden and you've lost your joy, whether you're a believer and you're endeavoring to go on with God, whatever category you fall into tonight, the truth of this verse resonates with each one, I trust. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Let the heart of them rejoice that seek the Lord. Come to Christ, and then you'll have joy unspeakable. We trust the Lord to bless his word to each of our hearts for his own name's sake. We're going to finish with hymn 170, please. Hymn 170. I'm rejoicing night and day as I walk the pilgrim way, for the hand of God in all my life I see. And the reason for my bliss, yes, the secret, all is this, that the Comforter abides with me. 170, standing as we sing.
The Comforter abides with me.
And just as we come to prayer, if there's one here and you say, well, as yet I'm not rejoicing night and day and I'm not walking the narrow way, come to Christ tonight, friend. If you have questions, stay behind. I'd be happy to be your servant for Christ's sake. But please don't leave without that joy that Christ can give. Heavenly Father, we thank thee for the Saviour. We thank thee for the real, lasting joy that he gives. Help us to rejoice evermore. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen.